Chapter 18. Some Secrets of Success on the Music Hall Stage. 22 years seems a long time when one looks back over it and reviews the many changes that have taken place in that period, yet it is over 22 years ago now since my first appearance in Bolton in 89, and during the whole time I've been appearing practically without a break except for short holidays. And the music hall artist has to work, I can assure you. Many people have an idea that stage life is a very easy business. I've overheard people talking about the big salaries earned by a man who comes on and sings a couple of songs, 20 minutes work. If this was a true picture, and if there was nothing more in it than this, it would indeed be an easy business. But it is not so. To begin with, in order to earn his big fees, the artist usually has to appear each night at several different halls, and with the two houses a night arrangement, he is obliged to start off pretty early. On an average night in London, I leave home about 5 and get back about 12:30. This is 7.5 hours. And a short day at that, some of my readers will say, but think what a lot is rushed into that space. And remember that so far from there being any early closing day, it is just the other way about with us, for we have matinees to perform at when other people get half a day off. It frequently happens that I'm singing at 4 halls, 3 of which give Saturday matinees. For example, looking through my engagement book, I find 1 round I have done has been at the Tivoli, London Pavilion and the Empress Brixton. 3 of them had matinees, so that on the Saturday I gave 7 shows. All this is work under high pressure. You have to be tip-top all the time, for when once you have made a reputation, you have to live up to it, which is a far harder matter than ever the making of it was. And one's work is not confined to merely appearing from 3 or 4 to 7 times a day. Songs have to be procured, tried and rehearsed, and there is other business that has to be transacted just as in other professions. The procuring of good songs is no easy matter. Many comedians pay annual salaries to songwriters in order to have first pick of their songs and in order that they may write specially for them. In this connection, much additional work is involved. New songs have to be tried through carefully, and as one gets very often a score of songs sent in per week from one quarter or another, many hours are taken up in this way, for one has to look at them all in case there might be a good one missed. If you reckon 15 minutes per song on an average, this means 5 hours each week on this job alone. Then, new songs have to be learned. I spend weeks sometimes working up new material. It is not merely a matter of getting words and music perfect. The best has to be made out of every line and every point of a song, which may have to be tried in 50 different ways before the right one is definitely decided upon. The method I usually employ with a new song is to learn it first by heart and then sing it into a phonograph. When the record is made, I listen to it and am able to criticise the rendering, taking notes as I go along when necessary. Another record is then made, heard and corrected, and this goes on till I get one which is A1 and which I can use as a model to get by heart and work from. So you see, work of one kind and another is involved in many different directions. Through all this, the essential quality of success is concentration. When trying new songs, all your mental energies must be devoted to the work. When learning a new song, every thought must be concentrated upon it, and when on the stage, your mind must not wander from the business in hand to think about the song you were learning earlier in the day, or the new songs that will arrive tomorrow morning, or the big contract you expect to sign before long, or whether you will be a success at the hall you are going to next. Concentration, concentration, and again, concentration, I regard as the main secret of success in any profession, and in that of the stage beyond all, because so many things occur there which tempt your mind to wander from the business in hand. And the one thing to concentrate upon beyond all else is the determination to win through, and having won through, to keep your end up. In one's early days, there are bound to be hardships, disappointments, and setbacks. The man who is cut out for success is he who takes all these in the day's march and goes steadily forward to the goal in view, in spite of them. And while I'm on the subject of success, there is another point worth mentioning, in case any read this who are ambitious for music hall fame. I'm firmly convinced that a main factor towards eventual success is sticking to one style of makeup and one style of song. Personality and individuality tell more on the music hall stage than anywhere else. Mix with the pit cues outside any hall you like, and if there is any talk going on about the forthcoming show, you will find people going with the express expectation of hearing certain men because of their particular style. The man who chops and changes about will do no good. If you are going in for Costa songs, go in for them and make a name for doing them well and always do them. Then, when people come to a hall to hear what your latest Costa song is, they won't be disappointed and disgusted to find you are not doing a Costa song at all, but have broken out in a fresh direction and one which they have not learnt to appreciate you in. There is a tremendous lot in getting used to a thing. If a man appears in one particular makeup and one particular style of song for years, the public get used to him and learn to appreciate his style. They don't want anything else from him. They want just what they go to hear. Too much versatility is a mistake, I'm sure. I only once made the experiment of changing my stage appearance. It was a frost. Those in front had been used to the red nose and peculiar costume, which is part of myself on the boards, and they were disgusted at not recognising me. The boys in the gallery would hardly hear me, and kept shouting such remarks as, "Ain't he lazy? Have you lost your clothes? Where's the raspberry tonight, Governor?"